Thank you. They recently redid these frescoes. Really should have had a drink before this.
You come through me?
I see they got the new.
Thank you.
of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you need me. I will hold your people in my heart.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
You know, there's a word in Italian that expresses it better than in English. Fino mente.
Hey! Giusto.
You know, we know we've been working on this since March. But today, finally, we have the opportunity to celebrate the sign of God's love in our midst. And so as we stand here before the altar, Alex and Kathleen invite us to pray with them as they begin their journey together. O God, who in creating the human race, willed that man and wife join, we pray, in a bond of inseparable love. These your servants, Alex and Kathleen, who are to be united in the covenant of marriage, so that as you make their love fruitful, they may become, by your grace, witnesses to charity yourself. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us be seated now to hear the word of God. We have been taking the course of the same word.
Amazing.
A reading from the book of Tobit. On their wedding night, Tobiah arose from his bed and said to his wife, "Sister, get up. Let us pray and beg the Lord to have mercy on us and grant us from deliverance." Sarah got up and they started to pray and beg that deliverance might be theirs. They began with these words, "Bless are you, O God, of our fathers. Praise be your name forever and ever. Let the heavens and all your creation praise you forever. You made Adam and you made his wife Eve to help his support. And from these two, the human race descended. You said, 'It is not good for a man to be alone. Let us make him a partner like himself.' Now, Lord, you know that I take this wife of mine, not because of lust, but for a noble purpose. Call down your mercy on me, on her, and allow us to live life together for a happy old age. They said together, amen, amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Deep the joy of being together in one heart, and for me, that's just where it is. All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. As we make our way through all the joys and pain, can we sense our younger, truer selves? All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. Forever as loving you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, put on, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, heartfelt compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If one has a grievance against another, as the Lord has forgiven you, you must also do. And over all of these, put love, that is, the bond of perfection. And let the peace of Christ control your hearts, the peace into which you are also called into one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as in all wisdom you teach and admonish one another, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus told the crowd, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Kathleen and Alice, I would imagine that you've been given a lot of advice. People tell you this is what you should do, what you shouldn't do, or how marriage plays itself out. I have one last bit of advice to give, and this is for Alice. Alice, you have a choice. You can be happy or right.
I'm going to choose happy. Very seldom am I right. I
okay. Well, you're up to a good start. But seriously, if anything, many times we do try, all of us, to pass on the best advice we can to people. And sometimes it's good and sometimes not so good. But what the church tries to do on the day of a wedding, particularly using the readings that we chose, is to kind of give you a direction. Because one of the things about marriage, like any commitment, is that it demands not 50%, but 100%. And we're human, and it's hard to give 100%. We can try, but we're going to fall short because we are human. When you think of some of the ideals that are set, even the things that you're going to say today, that I will love you in good times and bad, sickness and health, the death to us part. That's a pretty tall order, because it's going to demand, it's going to challenge you every day of your journey together, because it's going to demand that you give your best. And I'd like to say to you that it's almost impossible to do if it weren't for one thing. The one thing that today you're doing is you're placing your marriage in the hands of God. There's only one unconditional love, and that's God. And it's only God who can teach us how to love in that challenging way, that will demand everything that you can give. This stole I use for weddings, is a kind of a homily in itself. It speaks of love, because that's what the cross is. The cross is, the supreme example of love. What did Jesus say the night before he died? "No greater love has anyone than to lay down his life for his friend." The following day, on the cross, he laid down his life in a dramatic way. And when you look at the two rings, they're two slightly different colors and shapes, which means that there are two individuals getting married here. And you're going to remain two individuals. What attracted you to one another was your individuality. And yet, the things that count, you're going to be one. And very often the Christian symbol of marriage is to take the two rings and impose them on the cross. To kind of show that the way you're going to be able to live this way is if you die for self and you live for one another. And that's an ideal, and yet, like most ideals, it'll be tested by reality. It would be wonderful if we could say to you that your marriage, the day, every day of your marriage will be straight as the aisle as you're going to walk down. But you know that. You've seen that already. Just in all of us have seen it in the pandemic and
but you especially, because what it imposed on you and made you change plans and made you rethink and, you know, left you with some anxiety. But the amazing thing, from my perspective, is that you handled it well. You know, you kind of went with the flow. And that's kind of a good sign, because that's going to be what's going to happen in your marriage. You're not always going to know where life is going to lead you. But then, you know, it would be wonderful if it could give you a guarantee. You know, they live happily ever after. That's kind of a fairy tale answer, isn't it? The only guarantee that you give you is that you keep Jesus where he needs to be, the center of your marriage. Then there's a good chance that what you say in words today will become real as you live it out. There's a story in the Bible that has nothing to do with a marriage, but in another way about it. One day, Jesus looked out at this vast crowd of people who've been following him, and they were hungry. And he turned to the disciples and said, "What food do you have?" The disciples looked at him. Even 100 days' wages would never feed all those people. And Jesus said, "Well, what do you have?" And in the story, a little boy came forward, probably with his lunch, 5 loaves, 2 fish. And I like to think he said something to Jesus like, "It's not much, but if it'll help, you can handle it." And that's all it took. Jesus took what he had, and he fed him out. And you know, today, the two of you come before the altar with the realization that you're human beings, that you have your limitations. You have high ideals for you want to get married, but you're also human beings. And sometimes it'll look like too much. It'll look like the crowd that you can't see because you don't have the resources. But God just asks you to offer what you have. Your 5 loaves and 2 fish. He just asks you to take your limitations, your failings, your gifts, wherever they are, and place them in his hand. And then he'll do it. So if there's anything that, any bit of advice the church is giving today, it's this. Alex and Kathleen, don't ever settle for loving one another. It'll never be enough. But always strive to love one another, as Christ has loved us, and that will be more than that. And it might seem as if I'm speaking to our bride and groom today, but that applies to all of us. They're kind of a sign for us today of that reality, of that step in faith. But all of us, whether married or not married, we all are challenged to love others the way Christ loved others. And that means putting needs one another before one's own. And Alex and Kathleen, you know, are kind of a reminder to us today to be able to do that. Let's reflect for a moment before we enter into the sacrament. Mm-hmm. Please stand. My dear friend, you have come together in this church that the Lord may seal and strengthen your love in the presence of the church's minister and this community. Christ abundantly blesses this love. He has already consecrated you in baptism, and now he enriches and strengthens you by a special sacrament, so that you may assume the duties of marriage in mutual and lasting fidelity. And so in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intention. Kathleen and Alex, have you come here freely and without reservation to give yourselves to each other in marriage?
Yes.
Will you love and honor each other as man and wife for the rest of your lives?
Yes.
Will you accept children lovingly from God and bring them up according to the law of Christ and His church?
Yes.
Since it is your intention to enter into marriage, turn toward each other and join your right hand and declare your consent before God and His church. Alex and Peter. Hi, Alex.
Hi, Alex.
Take you, Kathleen.
Take you, Kathleen.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
I promise to be true to you.
I promise to be true to you.
In good times and in bad.
In good times and in bad.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
I will love you.
I will love you.
And honor you.
And honor you.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
Hi, Kathleen.
Hi, Kathleen.
Take you, Alex.
Take you, Alex.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
I promise to be true to you.
I promise to be true to you.
In good times and in bad.
In good times and in bad.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
I will love you.
I will love you.
And honor you.
And honor you.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
You have declared your consent before the church. May the Lord in His goodness strengthen your consent and fill you both with His blessing. What God has joined, no one must divide. Whenever we say something deep to each other, we usually have to express it in a symbol or a sign. The perfect sign at a wedding is a ring. If you can't see the end of that circle. We'll now bless the ring that Alex and Kathleen will wear as an outward sign of what is in their heart. Lord, bless these rings, which we bless in your name. Grant that those who wear them may always have a deep faith in each other. May they always do your will and live together in peace, goodwill, and love. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Kathleen,
take this ring as a sign of my love and fidelity.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit. Sorry. Get on.
Alex.
So that's on the back.
Alex.
Alex.
Take this ring.
Take this ring.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Ave Maria.
in the prayers of intercession. Heavenly Father, we place before you our needs, confident that wherever we ask for in faith, you will grant us.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For our Holy Father on earth, the Pope, all the bishops, clergy, and lay ministers everywhere, that they may lead us to deeper faith in God and a stronger love for others, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our president and all leaders of government, that they may be effective in achieving peace and eliminating poverty, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For married persons, that they may continue to give, be able to forgive, and find happiness deepen with the passing of each day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Alexander and Kathleen, now beginning their life together, that they may have divine assistance at every moment, the constant support of friends, the rich blessing of children, a warm love reaching out to others, and good health until a ripe old age. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are sick, lonely, discouraged, or oppressed, that they may be strengthened by God's help and aided by their friends, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially for Mary McKay, mother of the bride, and Alexander and Kathleen's family and all present for this wedding, that they may enjoy perfect happiness and total fulfillment in eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those personal needs, which we mention now in silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us now pray together in the words that Jesus gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
The church now gives us nuptial blessing to our bride and groom. Let us pray to the Lord for this bride and groom who come to the altar as they begin their married life, that they may always be bound together by love for one another. Holy Father, who formed man in your own image, male and female, you created them, so that as husband and wife, united in body and heart, they might fulfill their calling in this world. O God, who to reveal the great design you formed in your love, will that the love of spouses for each other should foreshadow the covenant you graciously made with your people, so that by fulfillment of the sacramental sign, the mystical marriage of Christ with his church might become manifest in the union of husband and wife among your faithful. Graciously stretch out your right hand over these your servants, Kathleen and Alex, we pray, and pour into their hearts the power of the Holy Spirit. O Lord, grant that as they enter upon this sacramental union, they may share with one another the gifts of your love, and by being for each other a sign of your presence, become one heart and one mind. May they also sustain, O Lord, by their deeds, the home they are forming, and prepare their children to become members of your heavenly household by raising them in the way of the gospel. Graciously crown with your blessings your daughter Kathleen, so that being a good wife and mother, she may bring warmth to her home with a love that is pure, and adorn it with welcoming graciousness. Bestow a heavenly blessing also, O Lord, upon Alex your servant, that he may be a worthy, good, faithful husband and a provident father. Grant, Holy Father, that desiring to approach your table as a couple joined in marriage in your presence, They may one day have the joy of taking part in your great banquet in heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down your heads for the blessing. Bow down your heads for the blessing. You know, this is the blessing of the church, and if you haven't guessed it, we are the church. You have a part, I have a part. Your part is amen. So after each invocation of the blessing, make sure that our bride and groom hear that amen so they know that it's our blessing for them. After each invocation, let us respond, amen. May God the Eternal Father keep you of one heart and love for one another, that the peace of Christ may dwell with you and abide always in your home.
Amen.
May you be blessed in your children, have solace in your friends, and enjoy true peace with everyone.
Amen.
May you be witnesses in the world to God's charity, so that the afflicted and the needy who have known your kindness may one day receive you thankfully into the eternal dwelling of God.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all who are gathered here. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Well, it sounds as if you have support. So with that support, the blessing of the church, go forth in peace. To love and serve the Lord and each other.
Thanks be to God.
That's right. Hello.